Imagine a world without cleanliness. Actually, wait, scrap that. Unfortunately, that wouldn't be asking much, since parts of our world are sadly already pretty unclean. Instead, let's imagine a world where everyone in every place adhere to a high level of cleanliness. No more stinky underground subways, no more overflowing rubbish bins in public parks, and no more disgusting public toilets. Today, we're going to talk about cleanliness in Islam and how Islam highlights the importance of cleanliness both on a personal level and on a societal level. Cleanliness is one of the most important values in Islam. In fact, it's regarded so highly that it is considered to be not just a good manner, but part and parcel of a person's faith. Just as Islam's religious scriptures take the time to describe how we should worship, they amazingly also cover, in great detail I might add, good hygiene practices that we should follow and maintain. There are numerous verses in the Quran and lots of hadiths about this very topic. For example, the Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, stressed the importance of cleanliness when he said, "Cleanliness is half of faith." The Quran also addresses its importance in chapter 2, verse 222, when it states, "Truly, God loves those who turn unto him in repentance and loves those who purify themselves." If you take the time to peel back the layers of grime leading up to our ultra-sanitized modern-day lives, it will soon become apparent that the human history of dirt is quite the saga. Long before cleanliness was commonplace, accessible, or even fashionable, like in medieval Europe, when people were discouraged from bathing because they believed it could lead to disease, the teachings of Islam already addressed how to maintain personal hygiene. So let's take a look at 9 personal hygiene practices that are outlined in the teachings of Islam. Number 1, looking professional and presentable. Verse 31 of chapter 7 of the Quran highlights the importance of looking nice and presentable. O children of Adam, wear your beautiful apparel at every time and place of prayer. Eat and drink, but waste not by excess, for God loveth not the wasters. Number 2, hair care. The Prophet used to care for his hair and use oils to keep it healthy, and he directed his companions to do the same. It was narrated that Jabir, a companion of the Prophet, said, "The Messenger of God came to visit us in our house. He saw a man with an uncombed hair and beard, and he mentioned, 'Wouldn't it be better if he took care of his hair?'" Number 3, perfuming. The Prophet Muhammad always put on perfume, especially when meeting people, such as meeting for the Friday prayers. Abu Sa'id al-Khudri, one of the Prophet's companions, narrated that the Prophet said, "Every Muslim needs to bathe every Friday, wear his best garment and perfume." Number 4, avoiding eating foods that cause unpleasant smells. Before the invention of mouthwash, toothpaste, and breath mints, Muslims were asked not to eat garlic, onions, and the like if they want to attend a social gathering. The Prophet is reported to have said in a hadith, "Whoever eats onions, garlic, or leeks should not approach our mosque, for the angels are offended by whatever offends the children of Adam." Now, just to clarify, this does not mean we cannot eat these foods. Rather, it's a reminder not to eat them before meeting people, especially in prayer. And this is explained in another hadith of the Prophet when he said, "He who eats garlic must not approach our mosque until its odor dies." Now, don't get me wrong. Garlic is an amazing superfood with many benefits. But let's face it, garlic breath is a real thing, which is why Islam takes it into account. Number 5, dental hygiene. Islam pays great attention to dental hygiene. The Prophet Muhammad said, "If I had not found it hard for my followers or the people, I would have ordered them to brush their teeth with siwak for every prayer." It is worth noting here that Muslims pray 5 times a day. The siwak is a tooth cleaning stick made from the Salvador persica tree known as arak in Arabic. Now, before you go picturing an ancient, outdated little instrument that has no place in our modern world, you might be surprised to hear that the International Dental Journal gave the siwak a very good review when it stated, "Apart from their antibacterial activity, which may help control the formation and activity of dental plaque, they can be used effectively as a natural toothbrush for teeth cleaning. Such sticks are effective, inexpensive, common, available, and contain many medical properties." Number 6, clipping the nails. Abu Huraira, one of the companions of the Prophet, mentioned that the Prophet Muhammad used to cut his nails and trim his mustache every Friday. Number 7, shaving pubic hair and armpit hair. At a time when this was not a common practice, and before the invention of shaving creams, disposable razors, and waxing, Islam was already very particular about body cleanliness. Muslims are asked to shave pubic and armpit hair at the very least every 40 days. Number 8, clean clothes. Even though we tend to take our clothes for granted, tossing them onto the floor after a long day out, if you think about it, clothes are a big blessing, protecting us from the cold, wind, and dust. God says in chapter 7, verse 26 in the Quran, O children of Adam, we have indeed sent down to you clothing to cover your shame. And for beauty and clothing that guards, that is the best. This is of the communications of Allah that they may be mindful. God also says in the Quran, and your garments do purify. Number 9. By far the most common act of purification for Muslims is the ritual cleansing or ablution, commonly known as wudu. Muslims pray at least 5 times a day, and before the prayer, they must perform wudu. God describes the steps of this ritual washing in the Quran when he says, O you who believe, when you rise up to prayer, wash your faces and your hands as far as the elbows, and wipe your heads and your feet to the ankles. And if you are under an obligation to perform a total ablution, then wash yourselves. Though the process is not labor-intensive, it is quite efficient in keeping oneself free from the muck that can build up over the day, especially when repeated multiple times a day. These are just some of the ways in which the Islamic teachings call on us to maintain cleanliness. Islam also instructs its followers in proper toilet etiquette and sexual hygiene. But of course, as awesome as a clean, stink-free world would be, it would still be pretty horrible if cleanliness and beauty were only skin deep. And that is why Islam, always seeking to achieve balance, also emphasizes the importance of spiritual cleanliness. Because no one likes a well-dressed sleaze bag, right? The Prophet Muhammad asked his followers to cleanse their hearts from all kinds of diseases, such as arrogance, envy, hypocrisy, deceit, lying, and many more. In the Quran, God says, certainly a mosque founded on piety from the very first day is more deserving that you should stand in it. And it are men who love that they should be purified, and God loves those who purify themselves. And of course, how could we talk about cleanliness without addressing it at the societal level? In Islam, there are many legislations and guidelines to protect the private and public environment by encouraging cleanliness of houses, roads, and public squares. Let's take a look at just a few. Number 1, home cleanliness. The purity of the place of prayer is a condition in the validity of prayer, and Muslims often pray at home, which necessarily means that they must keep their homes in a state of purity. This is one of the reasons why cleanliness is an inseparable part of belief in Islam. This cleansing includes not only the cleansing of dirt, but also any manifestations of immorality or sin. Number 2, the importance of the job of janitors and those in the cleaning industry. The preservation of the purity of a place is a great virtue, even though we often turn our noses up at these types of jobs. But we should keep in mind that the Prophet was reported to be in the service of his own household, meaning he didn't put himself above the often mundane tasks of cleaning and mending his home. Number 3, cleaning of roads and public places. Whenever we visit a new place or country, one of the first things we usually judge it on is its cleanliness. So it wouldn't be a stretch to say that cleanliness and progress tend to go hand in hand. The Prophet Muhammad warned of causing harm to the road or public places when he said, be on your guard against 2 things which provoke cursing. The listener said, O Prophet of God, what are these things which provoke cursing? He replied, relieving oneself in the waterways and in the shade of a tree and where people take shelter and rest. This is something that many societies still struggle with today. If you've ever had to hold your breath and plug your nose from the smell of urine as you walk along the streets of a big city, then you know exactly what I'm talking about. The Prophet also highlighted the great reward of removing harm from people's way when he said, if a man walks along the path and finds a branch of thorns on the road and removes it, God thanks him and forgives him. In short, cleanliness in all its forms, whether internal or external, is a beautiful thing. And a world without cleanliness wouldn't be a world we would want to live in at all.
If you liked what you saw, please remember to like, comment, share, and let us know what you think in the comment section below. See you all next time.